Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
How to overcome in a crisis. It's a pretty good topic because whether you like it or not, crisis is going to come to you and I. And I just looked up the definition of crisis, and it means a difficult or dangerous situation that needs serious attention. So that's where we're going tonight, and I've been mulling around this, and I shared a little bit on it in Women's Bible Study, on Mother's Day, because we're going to look at a woman tonight, and she doesn't even have a name, but it's a pretty bizarre story, and we're going to look at that, and we're going to look at what she did and how that can apply to our lives. But before we do, I'd like to just tell you a little joke. Now, here's the deal about my jokes. I'm not a really good joke teller, so I need you to laugh so that you can encourage me. Because I'll forget punchlines or I'll laugh at my own jokes because sometimes I think they're funny and nobody else does. But I found this and I thought it was funny. And Clarence and Anna had been married 75 years. Now, Clarence was 100 years old and it was his 100th birthday. And they were celebrating his birthday. And he looked so good. And they looked at him and they said to him, "Now, Clarence, how is it that you can look so good at 100? And he says, "Well, I have a daily walk, and I'm out in the fresh air, and I've been doing this for 75 years. And they said, "Clarence, 75 years? You've been walking every day out in the fresh air for 75 years. How have you kept such a rigorous routine?" And he said, "Well, that's easy. When Anna and I got married on our wedding night, we determined that whoever, when we had a fight, whoever was wrong would have to take a walk." Did you get it? So, Clarence, did I do it wrong? Are you laughing? Let me see, I don't have my glasses on, so did I say right? Well, you see, my wife and I were married 75 years ago, and on our wedding night, we made a solemn pledge. Whoever we had a fight, the one who was proved wrong would go outside and take a walk. That's even better. I don't know why I like that, but I just like that joke. All right, moving right along. If you got your Bibles, we're going to the Old Testament because the Old Testament illustrates the New Testament. The principles that we find in the Old Testament will give us keys and lessons, life lessons, that are principles in the New Testament that if we put them into our lives and work and let them work in us and work them in us, we're going to see results just like we saw in the lives of the saints of God in the Old Testament. They looked to the cross. They looked forward to the cross in the Old Testament. We in the New Testament believers, we believers now, we look backward to the cross. But we are all in the kingdom of God. And so tonight, looking at that topic, how to overcome in a crisis, I was thinking, now, how would you define a crisis? Well, I said Webster's defined it as a difficult or dangerous situation that needs serious attention. A difficult or a dangerous situation that's going to need serious attention, a crisis. So a crisis can come in many different ways. It can come through finances. It can come in relationships. It can come in health, a bad doctor's report, a crisis. It can come in a plethora of ways as we live on this earth. And Jesus said, in this world, you're going to have trouble, tribulation. But be of good cheer because I've overcome the world. And so now in my 65th year, I can look back on our lives, Jim and I can see that we have been able, by the help of God and the grace of God and the Word of God, we have been able to overcome many crises that took other people out. Marriages didn't last. Families didn't stay together. Churches split up. But God was gracious to us, and He allowed us to actually, in the crisis, get through it and become stronger and better. Because God's will in a crisis is not that we go under. It's not that we be swallowed up by this trouble. God's will in a crisis is that you and I actually stand up to the plate and we become the solution and the answer of deliverance in that crisis. Everything that happens to us, I believe by the Spirit of God, is a holy setup, and God has called us and He's appointed us to walk in victory, not defeat. So it doesn't matter what kind of trouble is coming at us. What really matters is how we respond to that trouble. Are you with me? And if I respond in the right way, then instead of that trouble overwhelming me, I am going to, in fact, overwhelm the trouble and take it out. Outlast it, outlive it. It's called longevity. And that is what God wants, is his people to stand on the earth as living memorials to the next generation to declare that God is faithful, to declare that his steadfast love never ceases, and that you can trust him and you can believe his word because he's true to his promises. So having said that, I want to look at a woman. And I love to study women because I don't see a lot of them in the Word of God. And this woman we're going to find in 2 Samuel. Now, let me just give you the story that's going on here. We're going to be in 2 Samuel, if you've got your Bibles, chapter 20. But before we talk about this woman, I want to give you the history of what's going on very quickly. David is the king of Israel. He's the second king. He has united the 12 tribes. Saul was the first king. But something horrific has happened. A crisis has happened in David's life. Probably the worst of all the trouble that met him. His son Absalom, his beloved son, has risen up, has betrayed his father, and has usurped authority, and he has gathered Israel together, and he has come against his father, the king, and he has fought and tried to usurp David from the throne of Israel. Now, Absalom did not succeed, and Absalom has just been killed. But there is an air of absolute distrust, danger, and insecurity all throughout the land of Israel. David has had a victory by God, but it's a very tumultuous victory, and things are extremely shaky. And like I said, this atmosphere is extremely dangerous. So when David goes back into Jerusalem after Absalom has been killed, David begins to gather Israel together, but something happens. And Israel gets angry with David's mother tribe, which is Judah, and they get angry with them, and a man named Sheba rises up and says, "Israel, he is not our king. Everyone to their tents." And Sheba begins to start a second rebellion. Now, this is extremely dangerous, and this is major crisis, because Sheba is going to usurp David off the throne for the second time, and he's just been attacked once, and he's weakened by his son Absalom. So David knows that he's got to do something very quickly. And looking at 2 Samuel chapter 20, and I'm going to read with verse 1, and I'm just going to read some verses here. "And there happened to be a rebel whose name was Sheba, the son of Bichri, a Benjamite, and he blew a trumpet, and he said, 'We have no share in David, nor do we have inheritance in the son of Jesse, every man to his tents, O Israel.' So every man of Israel deserted David and followed Sheba, the son of Bichri, but the men of Judah from the Jordan as far as Jerusalem remained loyal to their king." Verse 4, "And the king said to Amasa, 'Assemble the men of Judah for me within 3 days and be present here yourself.' So Amasa went to assemble the men of Judah, but he delayed longer than the set time which David had appointed him. And David said to Abishai, 'Now Sheba the son of Bichri will do us more harm than Absalom. Take your Lord's servants and pursue him, lest he find for himself fortified cities and escape for us.' So Joab's men with all of these other men and the mighty men went out after him. And they went out to Jerusalem to pursue Sheba, the son of Bichri." And the story goes on, and that David had asked Amasa, which he had actually worked with Absalom, but David is bringing him back into the fold. And he says, "Amasa, you go out and you gather the tribe of Judah, and you gather these warriors together. We got to go after Sheba." But Amasa has not come back in 3 days. Again, I said there's distrust. There is danger. There is insecurity everywhere, and no one trusts anyone. So David says, "We got to do something about this." And Joab has been David's general. Joab is a warrior, and he is a general. And he goes after Amasa to find out why Amasa is late. He kills Amasa. He comes to see him, and he says, "How are you, my cousin?" Because they were related. He's got a belt around him, and he's got a sword, and he takes his dagger out, and Amasa doesn't see it. And he grabs him, and he pulls him to him to kiss him, but instead of kissing him, he stabs him in the intestines, and Amasa dies and wallows in his own blood. And all the troops that he had gathered now are standing there, and they don't know what to do. Now, remember, Sheba is having another rebellion. So this is a mess. Israel is in a mess. And Joab knows that he's got to go get Sheba, so he pushes this dead warrior off to the side that he's just murdered and killed. And he goes and he follows and he runs after Sheba to stop Sheba because, like David said, and this is what David said, if we don't get Sheba, if we don't stop him and he gets to the fortified cities of Israel, because Israel's already left David, this is going to be worse than anything Absalom ever did. That's how dangerous this is. He's about to lose his kingdom for a second time. And so it is in this atmosphere of danger, war, betrayal, insecurity, great crisis, that we're going to find our little woman. And she has no name, but she's called a wise woman. Now, I want to look at her life tonight because she did some things. And if I look at what she did and I can apply those things in my life when there's trouble, when there's insecurity, when there's a bad report, when there's crisis, when things don't seem right, when I'm unsettled and there's no peace, then if it worked for her, it's going to work for me. Are you with me? Because what happened to her, even though it's horrific, those principles don't change in my life. Our trouble may not be hand-to-hand combat, and we may not be in crisis like they were there, where it was going to be killed or be killed. It was going to defend yourself or be slashed and diced to pieces. Armed warfare, we have not seen that here. This is as bad as it's going to get, folks. So if it can work with as bad as it's going to get, it can work for you and I. Are you with me? So looking at this, let me read on. So looking at 2 Samuel chapter 20, let's begin reading. And let's begin reading with verse 14. So Joab and his troops now went through all the tribes of Israel to Abel and Beth-Makah and to the Berites. So they gathered together and they also went after Sheba. So now he's gathering a mass of soldiers now that are all going after Sheba, who's in rebellion. Then they came and besieged him, Sheba, in Abel of Beth-Makah, and they cast up a siege mound against the city, and they stood by the rampart. And all the people who were with Joab battered the wall to throw it down. And then a wise woman cried out from her city, "Hear, hear, please say to Joab, come nearby that I may speak to you." And when he'd come near to her, the woman said, "Are you Joab?" And he said, "I am." She says to him, "Hear the words of your maidservant." And he said, "I'm listening." She spoke, saying, "They used to talk in former days, saying, they surely shall seek guidance in Abel, and they would end disputes. I am among the peaceable and faithful in Israel. You seek to destroy a city and a mother in Israel. Why would you swallow up the inheritance of the Lord?" Joab answers and said, "Far be it from me that I should swallow up or destroy. And that is not so." And the Joab answers and says, "Far be it from me that I should swallow up or destroy. That is not so. But a man from the mountains of Ephraim, Sheba the son of Bichri, by name, has raised his hand against the king David. Deliver him, and we will depart from the city." So the woman said to Joab, "Watch, his head will be thrown to you over the wall." Then the woman in her wisdom went to the people. They cut off the head of Sheba, the son of Bichri, and they threw it out to Joab. He blew the trumpet. They withdrew from the city, every man to his tent. So Joab returns to Jerusalem. Pretty bizarre story, don't you think? A little weird that I like these kind of stories, do you think? But this woman did what Joab couldn't do. She withstood David's foremost general and convinced him of his heir. She determines a solution that will save her city, and she convinces and sways an entire population to do what she has said to do, and she solves the problem, the crisis. So, having said that, let's go backwards now and let's look at what she did. Are you good? Because whether she's a man or a woman, she did what Joab couldn't do with his army. And I believe you and I, in a crisis, are called of God not to lose and not to fall victim and not to be defeated, but as this wise woman, unnamed in the Bible, we are called to stand our ground and to stand up and to decree a solution and to carry it out and to save that crisis from taking us out, our families, and anything else that God has called us to influence in the name of Jesus. Are you with me? It's time to get up and fight and not sit down and cry or be afraid. So what did she do? Well, let's go. I've got four little things tonight to share with you. Are you good? Let's go. And I'm going to start with this, and I wanted to bring this verse out because I thought it was important. Proverbs 16:32 says, "He who is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he who rules his spirit than he who takes a city. Whoever has no rule," Proverbs 25:28 says, "whoever has no rule over his own spirit is like a city broken down without walls." So what does that mean about this crisis? Well, in a crisis, this woman had the rule of her spirit. Her spirit was ruling not her emotions, not her flesh, not the circumstances, but her spirit. God wants my spirit, that which is joined to him, the wisdom of God coming to me from the Holy Spirit. He wants me to rule over my own spirit so that in trouble, in times of conflict, in times of insecurities like Israel was in times of danger, in times of bad reports, in times of broken relationships, in times when you don't know about your job, you're ready to quit, you're ready to get fired, you want to give up on it. If you can rule your spirit and not let your flesh rule you, you are stronger than a city with walls. But if you let your flesh, and if I let my flesh control me, then I'm like a wall city that has been broken down and I'll have no defense. And what is God saying? He's saying, I've made you to win, not to lose. I've made you to overcome, not to be, not succumb to trouble. So having said that, let's look at what she did. Number one, she had the courage to confront. The courage to confront. In a crisis, the elephant in the room that you don't want to talk about, the news that everybody knows, but nobody's really doing anything about. She had the courage to confront it. Now, let's just look at the scenario for just a minute. It's a walled city. Now, cities were walled for protection. Here's the scenario. Joab, the general, remember, he's just murdered his cousin. He can kill you and not blink an eye. He's a tough man. You don't mess with Joab. Joab has set up a rampart, and he has set up a battering ram, and the walled city is now under siege, and they are surrounded by troops, and they are battering and battering and battering and battering this walled city, and they are getting this walled city down one brick at a time, but this walled city is about to come down, and there is a murderous army behind him that is going to go through that broken walled city and destroy it. Now, I'm just curious as to where were all of the counselors and where was the mayor or where was the elders? What were they doing? But God says that an unnamed woman, a wise woman, she leans over the wall and she says, "Hey, hey, I need to talk to Joab." That's an amazing thing. I didn't see any men talking there. Now, no, this is not man bashing. But this is just a crazy wise woman. Verse 15, and they came and besieged the city of Beth Abel, and all the people who were with Joab battered the wall to throw it down. Verse 16, then a wise woman cries out from the city, "Hey, hey, hear, hear." That's "hey, hey" to me. "Hey, somebody, listen to me." She's up on top of the wall, a woman. And she says, "Please say to Joab, come nearby. I need to talk to him. You go get the general, and I need to speak to him." Well, they do. And Joab comes, and he says to her, "I'm listening." But before he says anything to her and she says anything to him, the first thing in my life that she's teaching me out of this little scenario, that is just this little few verses in the Bible, is when crisis comes, when trouble comes, when things are happening, when there is a wrong atmosphere, when things aren't measuring up and they're not adding up, and nobody else is doing anything about it, God's asking me and he's asking you to stand up and have the courage to confront. And sometimes that is the hardest thing to do because a lot of you want to run instead of confront. And I don't blame you, so do I. It's hard to confront the issues when no one else will to get to the bottom of the trouble. But God has never told us to hide our heads in the sand. He has told us to stand up, hold up our shields of faith, and take out the sword of the Word of God, the sword of the Spirit. In John 7:24, it says, look beneath the surface so you can judge correctly. Which brings me to another point about the courage to confront. Effective confrontation is a learned form. It invites another to consider change, but does not demand it. It is not diplomacy, tact, or smoothness of tongue. It is simplicity in speech, understanding in attitude, and honesty in response. It takes courage to face something that is intimidating. It takes courage to face a problem. It takes courage to confront when you'd rather just sweep it under the rug and not look at it or not think about it. No one else had the courage to stand on that wall and say, hey, go get your general. I need to talk to him. Number one, courage to confront. My question to you is, what's causing unrest in your life? What's causing crisis? Are you confronting? Are you courageous enough to look this thing in the eye and address it? Because point two that she teaches me is not only did she have the courage to confront, but listen, she had the patience to listen. Because this is what she says in 2 Samuel 20:20a. And Joab answered and said, far be it from me that I should swallow up or destroy. This is not so, but a man from the mountains of Ephraim, Sheba the son of Bichri by name, has raised his hand against the king, against David. Deliver him only, and I will depart from the city. She says to him, what are you doing? Why are you taking out a mother in Israel, and why are you taking out a city that is famous for its wisdom and its counsel? What are you doing, Joab? And Joab had another side to the story. Because when something happens and when crisis comes, there is always three sides to a story. Always. We're going to have to learn to listen to what we don't want to hear and be patient to let the other one speak. Because it says in Proverbs 18:17, the first to speak in court sounds right until the cross-examination begins. You have one side, they have another side, but God has the only side. There are two sides to every story. There are different perspectives. She didn't know why they were battering the city. She didn't know why they were going to take it out. She had to listen patiently while Joab says, listen, we're not here to take you out. We're here to take Sheba. Now, Sheba had gone into that city with his troops. Sheba was the rebel that she didn't know about. So I got to have the courage to confront. I got to have the patience to listen. And number three, I got to have the faith to speak. Because this is what she says. She says to him, oh, I love this, 20. Verse 2 Samuel 20, I'm going to be reading 20 through 21a. So the woman, again, not a name. So the woman said to Joab, watch, his head will be thrown to you over the wall. Hey, Joab, why are you taking us out? Well, Sheba, he's rebelling against your king. She says, oh, okay, watch. I'm going to throw his head to you over the wall. I don't know about you, but to me, that's speaking in faith because it hadn't happened yet, and she hadn't swayed a city yet, and Sheba was there with his troops. So you see, faith speaks those things, not that it sees, but faith speaks what it believes. Faith doesn't speak the problem. Faith finds the solution and decrees the solution before it happens. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Crisis comes to you. Trouble comes to you, whether it's relationships, whether it's finances, whether it's family, whether it's your job. It can come in a million different ways. Joab can be at your walls. The enemy can be at your walls. The devil can be there trying to take you out. You're going to have the courage to confront, not think it's not happening. It is. And somebody's got to speak to the elephant in the room and have the courage to say the hard things and say the things they don't want to talk about, even though it's going to mean a fight, even though it could be hard to hear. Then you're going to have the patience to hear the other side. And then you're going to have faith to declare and to speak, because faith speaks those things that are not as if they were. And faith speaks what it believes, not what it sees. And faith declares the solution, not the problem. Let me say it again. Faith speaks what it believes, not what it sees. And faith declares the solution, not the problem. What are you saying? What am I saying out of my mouth when I get a bad report? What am I saying? What is my perspective when everything around me seems to be falling? Listen, we haven't seen a real shaking yet. But if we're living in the last days, everything that can be shaken could be shaken. And don't just think that we're going to get raptured out of here. God said, in the world you'll have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. In this church, we preach ready rapture, not escapism. And if times get tough, how tough are we going to get and push back the darkness and bring in the light and be there faithful to decree and declare, thus saith the Lord, and bring the good news to a generation that's going to need some wise women on a wall that aren't afraid to confront the demonic, aren't afraid to look evil in the eye and say, oh, you're not going to do that. Oh, hell no. Say no to hell. Say yes to heaven. Say yes to the kingdom of God. Listen, I know I'm a grandma, but we didn't raise four kids and watch them all serve God because it was easy. We had to snatch some of them right out of hell and right out of the flames. Some of you have families right now that are in crisis. Those kids are so close to the flame that if you don't stand up, confront the issue, begin to confront the demonic, begin to get smart and brave and not afraid and speak those things that are not over those kids as if they were. Pray like you've never prayed and begin to use your weapons of warfare and not be afraid. Faith has the courage to confront. This woman had the patience to hear the other side. And number three, she had the faith to decree the solution. Number four, I'm almost done. This is a quick message, isn't it? Number four, she had the wisdom to act. I love this. 2 Samuel 20:22. Then the woman in her wisdom went to all the people. And they cut off the head of Sheba, the son of Bichri, and threw it out to Joab. The woman in her wisdom went to the city. She says, Joab, watch for his head. It's coming. She gets away from the wall. She goes back to her elders and back to her city. She sways the entire city to find Sheba off with his head, and it flies over the wall. Joab sees it. He takes his troops. They leave, and she has just saved the city. She solved David's problem. She has won the day. Because she had the wisdom to act. Listen, God's got the answer. It will come in faith. That woman heard. She had to listen to the other side. She had to figure out what the heck is going on. Because sometimes in a crisis, you don't know. Nobody knew why Joab was trying to take the city out. Nobody knew, and nobody would ask. And God is just saying, confront. Do you lack wisdom? Come and ask of me. I will give it to you in a trial and a test. James chapter 1, but ask in faith and don't waver. I want to give you my wisdom. He's been made unto us wisdom. We now have a divine connection to heaven. He is the head. We are the body. There is no disconnect. What Jesus sees, what he desires, what he wants, what his will is, his wisdom is downloaded right into us when we ask and we seek. This woman had to sway a city. That's why they called her a wise woman. So let's talk about this. What is God's wisdom? Dan touched on it, and he taught on it beautifully last Wednesday night. Go with me to the book of James, and I'm almost done. Are you all right with me? I know I'm this emotional, loud grandma. Can a leopard change its spots? The older I get, the louder I seem to get. So anyway, go with me to James. And I want you to look with me in James chapter 3 and look at verse 13. Wisdom. In a crisis, wisdom. I've got to have wisdom to influence. You see, I can have the solution downloaded by the Holy Spirit. I can speak it out of my mouth. But if I don't have the wisdom to carry it through, nothing's going to happen. Because faith without works is dead. What good it would have been if she would have said, Joab, no problem. We're going to take his head off, and you can go home. And she didn't have the ability or the influence to take that man's head off of his shoulders. nothing would have happened, and Joab would have had to take out that wall and destroy that city. You have to, I have to, have the wisdom to see it to the end. We have to become faith trigger pullers. What we've said we're going to do in faith, we have to begin to carry it out and walk it out, even when it seems impossible. I cannot tell you how many times my husband has stood in this pulpit in one of the many buildings. We had four different buildings. We started in a hotel. We went to the little green and peach building in the 80s and the 90s. Then we went to the teal Starbucks building in the 2000s. Then we moved and built this in 2003. So we've had these progressive buildings, and we've gone up every time. I cannot tell you how many times we have stood in these pulpits, and out of our mouths has come something that we hadn't thought about for one moment, but it was thus saith the Lord. It was the plan of God. It was the faith of God. We decreed it out of our mouths, and we had to then have the wisdom and the faith to walk it out, to flesh it out, and to see it come forth. It's going to take more than just speaking and decreeing. It's going to take the wisdom to act on it, and that means you're going to have to do things that you will not be able to do in the natural. You do not have the ability in the natural to do what God needs you to do, to bring the solution to the crisis. But in the supernatural place of faith, God will download to you the favor, the influence, and the wisdom of God to influence and to sway and to convince and do what you need to get done so the kingdom of God can come to your world and can solve that crisis. Are you with me? So let's look at what it says about wisdom. James chapter 3, looking at verse 13. It says, who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. Meekness is a word, is a power word in the kingdom of God. It's the power of God under the control of the agape love of God. It's the power of God, meekness. It's a new source of power. Satan rules in force. God rules in meekness. Power. Divine power under the control of agape love, submitted to agape love. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly and sensual and demonic. It's the flesh. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and everything, every evil there is. But the wisdom, now this is how she had the wisdom. But the wisdom that is from above is first. Now, what you and I need in my life, in your life, to begin to carry out the solution in faith, to influence, to change, to be able to see God's kingdom come and his plan come in the midst of the trouble, this is what we need. This is wisdom from on high. The wisdom from on high is first pure. Pure. What does that mean? It means there's no other agenda. There's no selfish ambition. It's not hiding my own little agenda. When I want to influence or sway in the kingdom of God and bring the plan of God, I can't have my own selfish ambition or agenda, or that's not wisdom. And God knows you can't access the kingdom of heaven by the flesh. You must walk in the Spirit. I must walk in the Spirit. Peace. It says, and then peaceable. What is peaceable? It's a desire to keep unity. Satan's kingdom brings division, divide and conquer. God's kingdom is a kingdom of unity. We are better together than we are apart. That's why when crisis comes to your marriage and Satan wants to break you apart and you're picking at each other and you're nicking at each other and the kids are fighting and there's that atmosphere of rebellion and there's that atmosphere of strife, you've got to confront it. You've got to be willing to listen. You've got to speak and decree the solution, not the problem. And then you've got to have the wisdom to act. And what is that wisdom? It means, second and foremost, that you are committed to the peace of God and the unity of God. It is not an absence of strife. Peace is the wholeness of God and the resources of heaven at your call. And whether all hell's breaking loose against you, whether the storms are coming against you like Jesus, and you're in the bow of a boat, and everybody else is running around thinking they're going to drown, but you're asleep on a pillow, and you wake him up and you say, Jesus, we're going to drown. And he gets up and he shakes himself awake. He says, oh, you of little faith. He walks to the side of the boat and he says, peace, be still. Disturb me from my nap. Instantly, everything changes. What, you think he doesn't want us to do that? We got to think bigger. We got to see our lives not just these small little insignificant lives, but as men and women of the kingdom of God, men and women that have the anointing of God, the Holy Spirit, the wisdom of God from on high. It is pure. It is peaceable. It desires unity. Listen to this. It is gentle. It's meek, power under the control of love. It's willing to yield. You know what that means? It means that I'm not stubborn. I'm not going to insist on my own way. I'm going to listen, and I'm going to yield if I need to sway and to influence. That's wisdom. It means that I'm full of mercy. What does that mean? Now, Sheba didn't get any mercy. He's in rebellion. But in your lives, in the new covenant, when there's crisis and you've got to sway and influence, God's wisdom is going to say mercy first. It triumphs over judgment. It's easy to nail somebody. It's easy to judge them. But the mercy of God supersedes judgment. He understands what's going on. He knows the secrets. He knows the ins and the outs that you'll never know. And if you'll let the wisdom of God flow into you, you will be able to have the power to sway and influence towards the things of God. One more thing. Without partiality, that means God has no favorites. Without hypocrisy, that means what you say you do. What you say you do. She had to influence her city to do a hard thing. She had to kill the offender. But she had the wisdom to act, and she got it done. She accomplished what Joab couldn't. She convinced a raging general that he was wrong. She swayed an entire city. She found the solution, and she saved the day in the crisis. All by courage to confront, the patience to listen, the faith to speak. Faith speaks what it believes, not what it sees. Faith declares a solution, not the problem, and the wisdom to act. Did you get something out of that? Simple little message. Little unnamed woman. I'm going to meet her in heaven. I'm going to say, I preached about you. We don't know your name, but wow, girl, you really did something. I love you guys. It's been a great day. It's been a wonderful day in the Lord. God wants to use us to bring solutions, not to run from trouble, but to confront trouble, take trouble out in Jesus' name. But let me do one more thing tonight before I go, because I don't know everyone here. And I look around and I see your beautiful faces. Talked about crisis tonight and a little unnamed woman in the Old Testament. But you see, none of this is going to work. None of it's going to happen in our lives if we're not first reconnected to God. And I don't know where you're at with God tonight. I don't know what would happen, but let me ask you this. If you were to walk out those doors and through no fault of your own, because life is brief and it's fragile, you were to die tonight, where would you open your eyes? Just you, by yourself, in your own little spirit, just talk to yourself. Where would you open your eyes? If you know that you know that you know that you'd open them in heaven, then start praying. If you're saying in your heart, well, I hope I'd be in heaven. I think I'm going to heaven. I'm trying to be good. I got to talk to you because you can't hope your way into heaven. You can't behave your way into heaven. And you can't think your way into heaven. No matter what you've heard or how you've been raised in this great country of ours, all roads don't lead to heaven. There's only one. And it's through Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God. And God says to get to his heaven, you must be born again. And born again doesn't mean that we climb back into our mother's womb. What born again means is that your spirit, because even though you are in this earthly tent, there's a time coming when every one of us is going to separate, die, and we are going to separate from this tent, and this body is going back to the ground because it's made of dust, but your spirit is going to live forever. And your spirit has been disconnected through something called sin. We're born into it. We're born with a terminal spiritual disease called sin. God said, all have sinned, come short of the goodness of God. That's why we can't behave our way into heaven. You can't be good enough for God because maybe you're good to somebody else, but in God's perspective, with God's litmus test of himself, my goodness and your goodness, our works, our behavior is like a filthy rag. God knew we couldn't save ourselves through behavior, through activity, through hoping. He knew that there was only one way that could save us, and that was if he himself came. became a man, all God and all man, walked the human experience, qualified himself to be the Lamb of God, climbed on a cross, laid his life down, became the sin that you and I all carry. It went on him. He laid his life down. He says, no man takes it from me. I lay it down and I pick it up. And he died, but he didn't stay because death couldn't hold him because he was God and he had no sin. Even though he took it, death couldn't hold him. And he said, if you will look to that cross, and this is how you get to God's heaven. If you look to that cross and you believe in your heart that I am who I said I am, all God and all man, that I came for you, I took on your sin, I died for you, but death couldn't hold me, and I'm the resurrected King of glory, and I will raise you up and change your life. When you look to that cross and you believe and you surrender your life to him, at that point, you become born again and you become a part of God's family in the kingdom of God. And at that moment in time, God takes you out of the kingdom of darkness, Satan's kingdom, and he brings you into his kingdom. And everything changes, even though nothing seems to change outside of you. Everything changes on the inside. And you begin this great adventure of walking out your earthly life with the king. It's an amazing, amazing thing. God can take the most unlikely, weakest, worst people in the world. I mean, my husband was the worst of the worst. And I'm just messing with you. He wasn't, but I was. I was pretty bad. I knew how to sin. I knew how to mess up, and I have no excuse. I knew better. I was raised in the church, but I rebelled very specifically. And God, in his mercy, got a hold of my heart and forgave me and cleansed me and made me brand new. He's not worried about your past. He's not in shock about your sin. He's just simply tonight saying, have you surrendered all of your heart and all of your life to me? And beloved, if you've never done that, he brought you here tonight so that you could make a decision and a choice that will change your destiny and your eternity and say yes to Jesus tonight. So this is what I want to do. I want to ask you just a couple of questions. Have you never surrendered all of your heart and all of your life to Jesus? Because if you haven't, tonight is your night. You might be thinking, oh, I don't trust myself. I know he's who he says he is, but I don't think I can. No, you can't, but he can. When I finally realized that I couldn't save me, but he could, and he didn't care about if I failed him, he would bring me and present me faultless and blameless before the Father, and he'd clean me up. I couldn't clean me up, but he could. Then he could save me. You can't do this, but he can. But you've got to come and surrender because he's a gentleman and he cannot and will not force himself into your life. It's a free choice. So, have you never surrendered all of your heart and all of your life to him? Have you been running from God instead of to God? You know this is true. You think, oh, I'll just wait later. But, you know, you don't have later. You got tonight. Today is the day of salvation. You don't have tomorrow because you don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. And as a pastor here, we have had letter after letter after letter after letter over the decades that we've been in this church. And the altar call has gone forth of people that said no at the altar call, and the next day they died. One man wrote us. His name was Justin. And he said, I should have said yes to Jesus because the next day, I was in a fight, I shot a cop, and now I'm in prison for the rest of my life. But I'm saved, and I got saved in prison. And even though I'll never marry the woman I love and I'll never have the family I wanted to have, I will go to heaven and I'll serve God in this prison. But he missed an opportunity. You have now, you don't have tomorrow. Have you been running from him instead of to him? The Holy Spirit's talking to you. Never surrendered all of your heart and all of your life. The Holy Spirit's talking to you. Have you backslid? Did you serve God, but you have messed up? You need to get right with God. I'm talking to you. This is what we're going to do with heads up and eyes open all over this auditorium. I'm just going to count to three. I'm going to tap on this microphone like that. I'm just going to ask you to raise your hands together. And you're going, oh, I'm going to be embarrassed. Well, who cares? A moment of embarrassment is not worth an eternity in hell, and hell is a very real place, and this is not a joke, and God is very serious. It cost heaven everything to save us. So all over this auditorium, you've been running from him instead of to him, I'm talking to you. Never surrendered all of your heart, all of your life, I'm talking to you. You've backslidden, you've disappointed yourself, I'm talking to you. Let's get right with God, because let God cleanse you. Are you ready? 1, 2, 3. Let me see your hands all over this place. Raise them high. I see that hand. I see that hand. Raise them high. I see that hand. Let me see over in this area. I see that hand there. I see that hand over there. I see that hand. Oh, everybody saved in this section? Really? I see that hand. I know there's 5 more of you in this section that need to get right with God. What about over here? Everybody right with God? Look, I'm not selling knives at the county fair. I'm telling you the best news that can ever be told you. There's a God in heaven, and he is the only God, and it's his heaven. He loved you so much he couldn't live without you, and he alone had the power to lay his life down and pick it back up, take the keys of death and hell, and he is the Savior. But he will not force his way into our lives. He says, if anyone comes after me, I will in no wise cast them out. Anybody else? I see that hand. I see that hand. Well, let's do this. There's hands going up everywhere. I'd like you to stand. We're about ready to close this service out tonight. You've been wonderful, precious family as you are. If you raised your hand, or you didn't raise your hand and you should have, I want you to grab everything that you brought to church with you. I want you to slip out of the aisles. Meet me right here at this altar, and we're going to change destinies tonight. So let's come. Jesus loves us. He is waiting and ready and willing. If you raise your hand, grab yourself, come and meet me at this altar. It's not too late to come if you didn't raise your hand. As we sing this song, come and join me at this altar.
I give you my soul.
Beautiful, beautiful. Quickly come, quickly come. Quickly come.
I live for you.
There's no other way.
Every breath
it's God's heaven.
I take.
Every it's God's heaven, so we do it God's way. There's only one way. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Come on, quickly. I know there's more of you. Don't dilly-dally. Let's run to this altar. God is real. It's either all true or none of it's true. And I can tell you it's all true. You can trust him. Quickly come. Quickly come. They're coming. They're still coming. They're still coming. They're still coming. They're still coming. May we never grow tired of seeing souls, men and women, children, come to the throne of God. Let the wells of salvation well up in this house. And may we drink freely from the joy of our salvation. Aren't you all lovely? Beautiful. Well, smile at me because you're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday party. You know, you were given angels to watch over you. And they've been keeping you alive all this time. They are having a party in heaven right now. They are high-fiving and they are dancing going, yeah! This is an amazing thing. God listens to our hearts, and you're going to pray a prayer. We're going to come, and we're going to ask you to go in just a moment with Dr. Becker, because we're not going to do it here publicly. We're going to take you into our believer's room, and just for a moment, we're going to pray with you and explain some things to you. We've got a book that we've written. After you say the prayer and you invite Jesus into your hearts, we give away friends around here, because you're going to have to learn how to walk by faith, how to walk in the kingdom of God. You're brand new. Brand new babies. When I had a baby, I didn't leave my baby at the hospital. I brought my baby home and took care of it. We want to take care of you for 5 weeks. If you'd like, we have a friend that'll meet you at church, buy you a cup of coffee, and explain 5 very, very important things. If you have any questions or if things happen, hard times, you can call that spiritual personal trainer. And they're there for you. You don't have to have one, but it's just a gift we'd like to give you, because God gives away life. So if you will just turn this direction, that would be my right, your left. Follow Dr. Becker. Your friends and your family can join you.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.